I've just come into the sitting room in the Duldig studio at 92 Burke Road, East Malvern. The house from which I married in 1962 and where our family lived since 1955. When I was growing up here, we used to sit in these chairs and we used to use this table for our afternoon tea. All the furniture is actually the same furniture which was in the flat in which I was born in 1938 in Vienna. There's a photo of the flat that we keep on the table here. And it shows my mother sitting in one of these chairs with this table in front of her and that lamp also in the picture. On the walls, there are the curtains that actually were in the room and that are here in this room now. And I think that probably is the most extraordinary thing of all. How did this furniture from done in Vienna in 1931, designed by a wonderful firm together with my mother, who also helped with the design and was her idea to have the wonderful lattice on the chairs. How did it actually make it to Australia? It's a long and it's a very dramatic story. In 1938, the year in which I was born, Hitler marched into Vienna and the world changed for us and for 200,000 other families, mostly Jewish, who were caught up in this terrible time in Vienna. Many did not escape, but we were among the lucky ones who managed to get out. We went first to Switzerland and then managed to get to Singapore, and then from there were actually brought to Australia as enemy aliens in 1940 by the British, and then finally ended up in an internment camp in Tatura, where we stayed for 1.5 years. So interned in Tatura when I was only 2 as an enemy alien. Then the war really took a dramatic turn. Pearl Harbor fell. Singapore fell. We came to Australia with very little, just a couple of suitcases and some drawings and some photos that my father had salvaged and taken with him around the world, but otherwise just hand luggage. How did this furniture and also wonderful works of art, which were done by my parents in Vienna, make their journey to Australia? My mother had a beautiful sister. Her name was Aurelie, or the family called her Rella. Rella was an actress, and she was courted in 1938 by a gentleman who'd come from France, a Frenchman, who was called Marcel Lenné. And she agreed to marry him, and they went together to Paris. Rella, as a French woman, was able to take every single thing that was in the apartment that had already been packed by my mother with her to Paris as her own. Down below the apartment house were huge cellars, and they managed to put all these crates containing all the items from the Duldig flat in the cellars of this apartment house. They kept a very, very low profile. Paris fell to the Nazis, and here underneath in the cellars were all these things belonging to a Jewish family hidden underneath. My aunt and uncle were really struggling during the war. They had no money, they had no food. My uncle had to walk to work because there wasn't money for the fare. And yet underneath in the cellars, there was beautiful furniture, there were fine carpets, there was fine crockery, fine tableware, silverware, and other items which they could have sold and which they could have used to help their destitute state, but nothing was ever touched. Marcel got a bit worried, and one of the pieces in the cellar was the head of a very famous Austrian rabbi, a Viennese rabbi. His name was Hayes, and my father had actually done a marble portrait of Hayes in the early 1920s. It was one of his first portrait studies. And he'd actually carved the name of Hyas in Hebrew letters on the base of this portrait. So here were these large Hebrew letters on the base of this portrait, clearly visible to anybody who would ever walk in on them. And my uncle knew this, and so one night, in the middle of the night, he took a hammer and chisel, and he went down into the cellar and he chiseled away the Hebrew letters, just in case somebody should get down there and look at what was in there. But still, nothing ever was touched. And nobody ever knew about this secret hiding place because they kept so quiet. Well, we in the meantime in Australia didn't know whether the family had at all survived. My mother didn't know whether her sister, Rella, had survived. And that was, I think, her greatest, greatest concern. Who of her family survived the war? In the East, in Poland, the situation was absolutely horrendous, and my mother lost all her family. Nobody in her family survived. Those people who had gone to Poland or lived in Poland from where she had actually been, where she'd been born, were all annihilated. My father's family was a little bit more fortunate in that some of them managed to move to the West, but again, his mother, his brother, his brother's family were killed in Przemysl, in the city where they returned to be safe at one point. And here in Paris, the last letters that my mother ever got when we were still in Singapore from her family, the very last letter came from my Aunt Rella. In 1944, my mother made yet another attempt through the Red Cross to find her sister. And she wrote to the original address in Paris, Rue Jean-Jacques Rousseau, 19. And lo and behold, exactly on her birthday in November of that year, a card, a visiting card, arrived at our flat in Ackland Street, St Kilda. Just her sister's name, Aurélie Marcel Lenné, and an address. Well, the euphoria was enormous. Imagine, suddenly her sister was part of her life again. As these early letters came, it became evident that Rella and Marcel had everything that belonged to our family in their apartment or in the cellars of their apartment house in Paris. It wasn't as important to have the things. It was more important to have the contact with the people. And my aunt decided, look, she would send out items to Australia, and they arrived on a ship called the Rembrandt, which was very opportune. And so the first lot of things that arrived were the furniture, this furniture here, and the bedroom furniture, and the sitting room bookcase, and everything else. And that arrived when I was 8, 1946, and it had to be lifted up into the first floor flat, and I'd gone to school that day, and my parents had taken the day off to receive these things. When I got back from school, the whole flat was crammed chock-a-block full with furniture, with a grand piano, with a bed, which was great for me because I'd been sleeping in a cot up until then. And the bed, however, was under the piano because there was no space for the bed on its own in the room in which I was sleeping. Eventually, in 1955, we bought this house at 92 Burke Road and moved everything here. And my mother felt, I think, that she'd come home, that she could set up again something like what she'd had in Vienna in 1938. And so this room became the sitting room where the lovely chairs are. And then we have this dining room where the bookcase is. And then we have the bedroom where the beautiful Viennese furniture was beautifully displayed. Everything had arrived entirely intact. My aunt had sent a list of everything, and we have that list here in the museum. And that details and itemizes every item, how many cups, how many saucers, how many plates, how much silverware, and so on, and the glassware. And there was one glass broken, out of the list. And it came to me that this place, the way it was much more than just a home, and even if it was the home of an artist. It was also the repository for many, many stories which people can really relate to and which are meaningful and which it's important to cherish and to keep for posterity. So that's kind of how this room has become a little Vienna. And we've had Austrian ambassador who came to visit and who said, well, there's not another place he's seen in Australia that is so Viennese as this particular house.